capital known as the Big Apple.
Send it in, Big Fella!
New York City. The streets stay gritty, filled with electricity. New York City. It has the power to push you past your limits.
A tick in the tin.
It gives you what you need to overcome any challenge, complete any quest, and be the best.
Beautiful play.
See everything move at a fast pace. Make a fast break to be in last place. It's just a state of mind. Everything you need for success, you can find. These teams will use the energy, the drive that makes this city alive. To separate the weak from the strong. To find out who belongs. Who needs to get gone from the Big East Championship.
Getting in the lane.
Oh, my goodness. He exploded to the bucket.
It was the East Coast capital known as the Big Apple. New York City.
Welcome back to New York, and on any given day, something or someone is making news in the busiest city in America. Tough to stand out from the crowd, but in a town crowded with sports teams, St. John's did exactly that, grabbing headlines with their performance yesterday landing on the back pages of the New York papers. But the Red Storm will be old news if they don't win today. And their opponent, Marquette, writing its own story, is one of the biggest surprises in the Big East this season. Welcome back to Championship Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Day two of the Big East Championship, presented by New York Life. St. John's and Marquette, the loser becomes the 16th to exit the tournament. St. John's coming off a win yesterday against Connecticut. Marquette playing its first game of the 2010 tournament. Earlier today, here at Madison Square Garden, we watched Georgetown handle USF to advance to play Syracuse at noon Eastern tomorrow in the quarterfinals. Two more games tonight, Notre Dame, Seton Hall, Louisville, Cincinnati. Dave Pash with Doris Berg and Fran Fraschilla. Beth Mowens here as well. Well, guys, St. John's played maybe its best game of the year yesterday. Not really a surprise they won, but how they won, dominating UConn.
Well, you're right, Dave. You know, both teams understand playing hard is a skill. And I thought St. John's yesterday played with passion and purpose, great energy. And for a moment, it was signs of the past in terms of the great tradition here at the Garden.
Meanwhile, Marquette had a terrific year. They really can shoot the three. Fun to watch.
Every descriptor you want applied to a team, if you're Buzz Williams, you got to be thrilled. Unselfish, hardworking, and I'm not sure they've got the fifth most talent in the Big East, but they finished fifth because you will flat not outwork this club.
Lazar Hayward, terrific player, featured in our Star Watch along with St. John's Malik Booth.
When it comes to the Red Storm, the great tradition of point guard play, Mark Jackson, David Kane, and yesterday Malik Booth was outstanding, the catalyst in a terrific win.
Well, if you're St. John's, one of your biggest concerns is Lazar Hayward and the kind of range he has. It's the first time he's been the featured scorer. He's always been overshadowed. The guy can flat out play the game. His numbers reflect that.
The starting five for the Red Storm. Technically a home game for them, even though they're the 13 seed. Booth and Paris Horn in the backcourt. Horn had 13 points yesterday. Sean Evans had his best game of the season, 19 points, 10 rebounds in that game. He's joined by DJ Kennedy, who leads the team in scoring on the season, and Anthony Mason. For Marquette, a lot of guys can really shoot the basketball. Ackert second in the Big East in three-point shooting. Johnson, Odom at the top five and as well. Hayward, a lot of people surprised he didn't make first team All-Big East. He was a second-teamer. And Jimmy Butler had two game-winning shots at the end of contest this year, one at Connecticut, the other at St. John. We mentioned Butler's game-winning shot against St. John's in the only meeting this year during the regular season. That was at Carneseca on February 24th. Butler, in one motion, picking it up, turning and firing as Marquette won that game in overtime. Four of their last five games to close out the season went to overtime. Marquette winning three of those at Corbett, Bob Donato, Jeff Clark. Our officiating crew for this second round matchup here at the Garden.
Well, one thing that jumps out at me early is going to be guard play. A lot of junkyard dogs on both teams, scrappy guys, handling the ball and executing half-court offense is going to be key.
I love Jim Calhoun's comment about Marquette. He said, unabided team effort, enthusiasm, you can accomplish a great deal. And I'll tell you what, they've got some good players. I know you and I are huge fans of both Jimmy Butler and Darius Johnson Odom. Obviously, their focal point is Hayward. But this is an impressive Marquette team in terms of how hard and how well they play together.
Marquette led the Big East in three-point shooting. They also don't give up a lot of points in conference games. They gave up the fewest, but they were also 15th in field goal percentage defense. The team shoot well against them, even though the Golden Eagles don't give up a lot of points. St. John shot it extremely well yesterday against Connecticut. See how they fare today as they'll start with the basketball. Joe Lenardi in his latest bracketology has Marquette in. St. John's at 17-14, 6-12 in the league, would need to win the tournament to get the automatic bid and have any chance of making the NCAAs. Mason missing the first shot.
Yeah, the impressive thing about Marquette is their ability to break you down and get and play the game in the paint with their guards. Get a piece of the paint is the motto.
There's Darius Johnson Odom, a junior college All-American last year, had a terrific season, shot 48% during the regular year from three-point land, and gets Marquette off to a good start here.
But as good a shooter as he is, wait till we see him attack the rim with that dribble and that strength.
Foul on Jimmy Butler. Buzz Williams, only 37 years of age. Kind of an interesting route. He was the head coach at New Orleans, then left that job to be an assistant under Tom Crean at Marquette. Then when Crean left for Indiana, got the job there.
He was pretty prophetic, because New Orleans has downgraded their program to Division III.
The extraordinary number on that graphic was how many close losses they had early in conference, and they never lost this group. They hung together, and late in the season when they needed to win close games, they did.
No losses by double figures for Marquette, one of seven teams in the country. That's it. Here's Kennedy. Booth, interesting matchup. Booth and Acker, both 5 feet, 8 inches tall, going up against each other. Evans with one on the timer. Can't get it to go. And Hayward clears. Here's Kubion with a pull-up two. And Mason gets the rebound.
In some ways, guys, these teams are mirror images of each other. Not a lot of size, good quickness, a lot of athleticism. And you see St. John's now going to that offense they put in late in the year, the open offense, kind of like West Virginia's five-man motion.
Horn way off. And Evans trying to save it. Here's Butler for Marquette. Nobody picked him up. Takes it in and called for the offensive foul. That's two quick ones on Jimmy Butler.
Well, that's huge. I mean, this guy was one of the first guys mentioned when I talked to the St. John staff, because of his ability to do this, get off the dribble drive. You come in a little bit late, and I know you talked about this yesterday, Fran. The time when you have that restricted area, Mark,
right
underneath the rim. I look forward to that. I think what it does is it gives you, not that it's necessarily in play there, but just because it gives a little bit of help to the officials. There's a definitive mark on the floor. It makes their job a little bit easier, and we should be for everything that helps the guys in the striped shirts.
Joseph Folsom for Butler has got two fouls. Kennedy called for traveling. It's the sixth year at the helm of St. John's for Norm Robertson. We can't do a Red Storm broadcast without talking about his future, it seems like. He's continued to survive year after year. Has he done enough to earn a seventh season, or does he have to win today?
You know, my question is, St. John's has got a bunch of juniors, a lot of veterans. You better hire somebody who's really good if you're going to replace Norm Roberts, because these kids love playing for him, and they're just starting to taste a little bit of success.
Roberts with only one winning season prior to this year. That was in 2007. The fact they got 17 wins this year is actually the most in his tenure.
Well, Jim Boeheim said it at the press conference for the Coach of the Year Award. He said, hey, St. John's is going to be very good next year. And Jim Calhoun echoes the same sentiment, Scores.
You're older, you're wiser, you're more experienced.
Kubion hits a three. Marquette's two field goals, both from behind the arc. That's what they do best.
What I love about Marquette is they play the game from inside out, whether it's a pass inside to Hayward or Butler or the dribble drive kick out. They get those threes because of the ability to get the ball deep.
One thing with the Norm Roberts team, you will not see him quit no matter the score. They play very hard for him. Nice spin. Boy, Sean Evans is really off to a great start here in the Big East tournament.
A terrific frame. You allow him to get that kind of opportunity that deep in post position. Forget about it. He's just too strong up top.
Did you just say forget about it?
Forget about it.
Well, I like it. They did this yesterday against Connecticut. They really exploited Evans's ability as an undersized big guy to use that dribble and create some ISO opportunities for him.
Well, the point you were making the prior trip about Marquette and getting, you know, opportunities working inside out, that's without a legitimate back-to-the-basket guy.
Yep.
Turnover by Marquette. Kennedy on the other end gets the basket. St. John's down two.
Now, they're long, they're athletic, and the reason that they're going to try to get some transition opportunities, but that five out, nobody underneath. I saw yesterday, you guys calling the game, there was plenty of trips up the floor, Fran, where everybody was above the free throw line for St. John's. That gives you a lot of driving opportunities.
Yeah, especially for a team like this, as you mentioned, neither team has a real post player in terms of scoring.
Acker hits a three, the third triple for Marquette, and he shot it at a 50% clip during league games. That was good for second in the Big East in three-point shooting in conference games only. Rare that you see a guy actually shoot it better in conference from behind the arc than they do in the pre-conference, but he did.
Well, how about a guy that's 5'8" shooting it over the big guys?
Kennedy facing the double team. Shot clock at 8. Down to 5. Got to give it up to a guard. Here's Booth with 2. Booth got it away. Shot clock violation. Marquette led the Big East in three-point shooting during the regular season, 11th in the country. And they've already got 3 triples here. Less than 5 minutes gone by. Game 2 of 4 today at the Big East Championship at MSG. Back in New York City, game 2. A 4 here, day 2 of the Big East Championship. So far, St. John's just 2 of 7 from the field and down 5 to Marquette.
Well, and they've got to handle the traps, and Marquette is going to work hard the entire possession. We call it hard shows. There's a hard show by Lazar Haywood. Sticks his hand in. Look at the activity, the kind of ball pressure they're getting. And you've got to be able to operate your offense, Fran, a little bit closer than where they're trying to, but active traps, long traps, everybody adjusting out of it.
Yeah, great rotations. And you can think of it this way, Doris, a team so good offensively in the pick and roll like Marquette is, corresponding, you'd think they'd be good defensively because they understand how to guard pick and roll. That was a great example right there that you pointed out.
Well, you spend your entire practice on the defensive end dealing with it.
That's exactly right.
Some would say we've had some hard shows so far here at the Big East Championship with 3 games that have not been close. We'll see about this one here with Marquette out to a great start. 3 threes already.
Hey, these are just the appetizers.
Mason with the steal for St. John's. 3-on-3. Kennedy will pull it out.
Look how hard Bikes works. I said this earlier, Doris, I've not seen a team all season long that plays with the intensity of Marquette, and they play just as hard on the offensive end.
They play as hard as he coaches because Buzz Williams works.
Mason posting up. His dad spent a handful of years here at the Knicks, and Mason, because of injuries, has now spent a handful of years here in New York at St. John's. Gets the basket there.
If you're going to pass it in that easily, Marquette's going to have to pressure that ball harder. That was a good look.
Here's Hayward, ended up second team All Big East. Some thought he was a player of the year candidate, but so many good players in this conference, obviously. Kennedy over Kubion. And long rebound to Dwight Bikes. Acker racing down court, gets the layup.
There's a pulling guard play by Joseph Fultz. He just was running to the rim and acted as a shield for the 5'8 senior.
Like a small running back, sometimes you can't find him.
That's exactly right. Let's take a look. Darren Sproles right there.
Horn off the mark. Bikes clears. Acker with the entry to Hayward. Count it and a foul, Evans. Simmons.
Well, and I thought the delivery was going to be too late. I wasn't sure he had the necessary angle to make the pass. That is a lost art a lot of times, Franny, that post-entry pass. I thought they missed him initially. When you could see the numbers on your post guy, get it to him. But the ball's delivered in the right place, and nobody better at finishing around the rim. And first time in his career, he is the featured scorer. He's been an underrated player his entire career. Nice to see this guy break out.
Yeah, what I love about Lazar Hayward, people talk about him playing out of position for 4 years, but I don't agree. I think he's the classic mismatch forward. You see him score inside. We know he shoots the three. He's the perfect mismatch forward for a team that takes big guys away from the basket and can post up guys his size.
A lot of people wondered how many games they would win with Jarrell McNeil, Dominic James, and Wesley Matthews moving on. But it's been a terrific year for Marquette as Booth, smallest guy for St. John's, had a look at an easy one and missed.
But there's been an Achilles heel for St. John's this year. It's been on the offensive end because most nights, Doris, they'll give you the effort defensively.
Yeah, and if you're Marquette, you're thinking let's limit second chance opportunities and take care of the ball. They do those two things. I think they got a very good shot of winning.
Fultz on the miss. Here's Kennedy for St. John's. Red Storm 5-4 at Madison Square Garden this year, including the win yesterday against Connecticut. Entry pass to Burrell, and he puts it in, and a Marquette foul.
Yeah, this guy may be a key. Dwight Hardy not available because of knee bone bruises, and Dresden Burrell off the bench. He's a big guy who can shoot the ball from outside. You see his body goes up. And the ancillary benefit is not just the 2 points, but picking up a foul on Lazar Hayward as well.
His first third on Marquette. You mentioned no Dwight Hardy. He is their second leading scorer, 10 points per game. Didn't play yesterday. Another guy stepped up. That'll have to be the case again today as Kubion returns for Marquette, replacing Bikes. Malik Stith on the floor for St. John's, replacing Malik Booth. Screens by Marquette, ends up with an open look for Hayward. Got it. Three for Lazar Hayward.
Well, that was outstanding. As an example, we talked about Marquette being so good defensively in the pick and roll. That time moving pick and rolls randomly.
High arcing shot won't go by Horn. Here's Marquette in transition. They're 4 of 4 from three. Four different guys have hit threes. Make it 5 of 5 from behind the arc. Second triple for Hayward. Timeout, St. John's. Lazar Hayward, the early story at Madison Square Garden in game two on day two at the Big East Championship. He scored the last 8 points for Marquette, which leads by 10. He's one of three players, guys, in Marquette history with 1,500 points and 800 rebounds. That tells you about his importance to this program. Kennedy on the drive, no. And there's Hayward hustling.
Notice, Doris, how many hustle rebounds they get, those 50-50 balls. Now, St. John's a pretty tough-minded team, but Marquette comes up with a lot of loose change.
Hayward could not handle the pass. Marquette turnover.
Well, Hayward didn't come up with that one, but take a look. He's dangerous because he can really hurt you inside. We've seen it already, but he stretches the defense with that perimeter J as well. How do you guard this guy? Pick your poison with Lazar Hayward. Marquette on a roll.
Marquette on top by 10, trying to advance to the quarterfinals to play Villanova at 2 Eastern tomorrow. Syracuse, Georgetown will be the first game. Still two more games tonight on the docket on ESPN at 7 Eastern. Notre Dame, Seton Hall, followed by Louisville and Cincinnati at 9 on ESPN.
Another backyard brawl looming there. Pitt and West Virginia advance to the semifinals. They had a couple of great ones, including that, what was that, eight overtimes? I think it was actually three. I was the only dumb guy in Stillwater, Oklahoma that night that turned the game off with 30 seconds to go in regulation.
There were plenty in the same boat with you last year that turned it off in the six overtime game between Syracuse and UConn here at the Garden. Three from the corner won't go for Justin Brownlee. Here comes Johnson Odom for Marquette. How does St. John's guys do a better job defending the perimeter? Marquette is 5 of 5 from three already.
Well, I think one area that they talked about was switching some of the perimeter screens. To Fran's point, as you see Hayward get another one off, they're hesitant to switch with Hayward because he's so big. It would be a mismatch automatically. That's why he got his three right prior to going to break from deep.
And I think the other issue for St. John's is when you switch against a team that has so many good drivers, you're going to create an inadvertent mismatch somewhere.
The defense by Hayward. He was up around two steals a game during the regular season, poked it out of Burrell's hands. Here's Brownlee with it now. Shot clock inside of 10. Kick ball. Shot clock to 15. Championship week presented by Dick's Sporting Goods continues tomorrow at 12:30 Eastern. Phillips 66 Big 12 Championship quarterfinal, Texas Tech, which beat Colorado, playing number one Kansas. ACC tournament tomorrow night, 7 Eastern, Carolina and Georgia Tech. Any chance, guys, any chance North Carolina gets on a roll at the ACC tournament, and you just not see it happening?
I just don't see it happening. Their guard play has been just so poor.
Booth on the miss, last touch by Marquette.
Seeing some things that you would say, you would think are inconceivable. North Carolina playing on the first day. A Jim Calhoun coach team here at the Garden. Flatby uninspired and quit for stretches of that basketball game. And Coach Calhoun deserves better. And it's been a tough year all along. Jerome Dyson struggling as much as he did and pretty much being apathetic for a guy who has a history of being such a tough-minded competitor. Hard to watch.
Johnson Odom missing the shot. Brownlee out of there with it.
Look at that effort.
Yep. And then Booth with the save. Good off of Acker. Buzz Williams runs down towards midcourt to argue with Ed Corbett.
And I think he just got warned by Jeff Clark and said, Coach, stay in the coaching box, please.
He was almost in Norm Roberts' coaching box.
Of course, Louis used to do that. I think that's why they put the coaching box in. Back in the old days, Coach Carnesecca was coaching his team and the other team from these Madison Square Garden sidelines.
Brownlee another three-point try. Missed it again. St. John's now more than 3 minutes without a point. 0 for 5 from three-point land. Hayward on the drive. That's what you talked about, Doris. Yep. They want the challenge. He took it to the rim. Somebody picked him up, though, and now Acker with it. And he's fouled by Booth, and that's two on Booth, three on St. John.
And that's really important because Malik Booth was so solid yesterday. Malik Stith, not quite as solid. The youngster from Hempstead, New York. The two Maliks, the dueling Maliks.
And Marquette has built this lead doing exactly what they said they needed to do. Two offensive rebounds by St. John's in his first half, but both of them came early. It's been one contested shot. They've limited any chance. And again, in an offensively challenged team like St. John's, sometimes their best offense is an offensive rebound putback.
The unfortunate thing for St. John's is they're playing against a team, Doris, that values the ball as much as they do. This is a team that rebounds by committee on the defensive end. Look how they attack the paint.
Acker tried to force it inside into a double team. Good play by Brownlee. Stiff. Got it ahead. Horn with the jet.
It's exactly how they have to generate offense if you're Norm Roberts. Every time there's been a couple of post passes where, one, they're telegraphing, and two, they're trying to complete with a lot of red jerseys around. Reverse the basketball, let your guy cut across the lane and post on the weak side.
First points for St. John's in over 4 minutes, and then Horn picking up the foul out on the perimeter, his first and the fourth on the Red Storm. Anthony Mason Jr. back in. Hamstring injury earlier this year, the foot injury last year. Here's a guy that averaged 14 points per game 2 years ago. They might need Mason to have one of those games today if they're to knock off Marquette. Both teams making a bunch of substitutions here.
Now, I don't think you can underscore the loss of Dwight Hardy off the bench. When you look at Hardy particularly, and he is a guy that gave them instant offense. DJ Kennedy and Hardy really were providing about 40% of their shots and scoring opportunities before he went out.
Played 36 minutes off the bench when these two teams squared off earlier this year.
That game, as we showed you, the top of the telecast came down to the wire. Jimmy Butler with the game-winning shot. Butler's only played about a minute in this game because of foul trouble. Here's a Marquette offensive foul on Kubiak.
Two of the hardest-working defensive teams you'll see, not only in the Big East, but in the country. Lots of jerseys around that post-entry pass. Don't throw it, because if you make a mistake, this is their best opportunity. An easy flush in transition. Can New York get a little magic back with one of their teams? St. John's trying to make a push.
If you can make it here, you'll make it anywhere. New York City!
Well, John, our second game here at the Garden, very similar to the first game where Georgetown knocked off South Florida. The Bulls could not shoot, neither can St. John's right now. 26% from the field and 0 for 5 from 3, while Marquette is 5 of 6 from behind the arc.
So you take an offensively challenged team and you extend your pressure a little bit and give them limited shot clock to work with in the front court.
St. John's shot it really well against Connecticut. Back shot 60%. In the second half, Doris, you were talking about, seemed like the effort wasn't there for the Huskies. They went the whole year without allowing a team to shoot 50%. Then in their last two games, South Florida at the end of the regular season yesterday against St. John's, it happened in back-to-back games, over 50% by an opponent.
When's the last time you saw a Jim Calhoun team give up 8 dunks in the game? St. John's was able to manufacture a lot of easy baskets because of the effort, I thought, on the defensive end and sloppy turnovers.
Yeah, flat out worked them. And Andy Katz talked to Jim Calhoun's agent, which that contract is yet to be signed. And I don't know what's going on, but I know this. Nice backdoor cut. I think after all Jim Calhoun has achieved at the University of Connecticut, and you talked about yesterday his greatest strength maybe being that he's a bad loser. Bottom line is he put the University of Connecticut, along with Gino Auriemma, on the map as an institution. And I don't care how you work it out if you're Jeff Hathaway, but that contract needs to be signed. Something definitive must happen. He deserves better than what's going on.
Ball was on Kennedy, his first, sixth on St. John's. Of course, Calhoun missing 7 games on medical leave. 67 years of age.
Well, there's few coaches, Dave, that win on the force of their personality. Some guys win because of the program they're coaching, whether it's North Carolina. No offense to Roy Williams. I'm just saying the great tradition of North Carolina, Kansas, UCLA. Jim Calhoun won at UConn on the force of his personality, and not because they had a great arena or great facilities. It was built on his intensity over the last 24 years.
That's right. I remember Rick Pitino, before they got good, saying Connecticut's a sleeping giant. And he was the giant on the sideline. He woke it up.
Really, their run started the year after Pitino led Providence to the Final Four. Connecticut won the NIT. And a couple years later, the Huskies were a national contender. As Hayward, who scored the last 10 points for Marquette, gets the loose ball. St. John's continuing to struggle shooting the basketball. Only the second missed three by Marquette as Acker was off the mark there.
Now watch that jump shot, Doris, and not one yellow jersey went to the offensive glass. Everybody got back to the paint, and St. John's had absolutely nothing in transition.
Marquette does not have an offensive rebound yet in the game. So if they start missing, and that might be what St. John's needs to get back in the game, but they're not missing a whole lot of shots right now.
And it's a strategy, Dave. A lot of coaches will eliminate fast break opportunities for the opponent by not sending anybody to the glass so they can ensure that everybody gets back.
And they've got a very good score, and this is what differentiates these two teams. A consistent night by night, as you said, a hard matchup because of where he is at the four. He's got deep range. That was the major concern for St. John's coming in. And Buzz Williams is an interesting guy. I mean, we went to practice early in the year. We couldn't have been more impressed. Their routines are what this team is about. 3 days out, 2 days out, a day away. They go to practice for the first time here, and they've got to share a gym. They started out so bad that he sent them away from the gym. He said, get out, and let's come back in and restart. It's interesting how you try to handle 17 to 22-year-olds.
No, it's true. You know what? He's got a humanity about him that the players love. They work just as hard as they did for Tom Crean, who built the program. There's a way he relates to guys that the players absolutely will play as hard as they can for.
Mason off the mark with a turnaround, and Fultz gets to the loose ball. Buzz Williams embodies climbing the ladder. Here's a guy that made $400 a week, somehow talked his way into opportunities. He was at the Final Four 1 year, just handing out resumes, sleeping in a hotel lobby. Got a job at UT Arlington, making $400 a week for Eddie McCarter. Now at 37 years of age, he's the head coach where Al McGuire once coached. First offensive rebound for Marquette.
And that was because it was a long three. You notice that? They chased down a long miss.
Another one of those 50-50 balls, maybe, Fran, that
Absolutely.
You talk so much about with this club?
Yeah, with Marquette, it's 70-30, Doris. That's, yeah. That's why they've had the success they've had this season.
Marquette without a field goal in the last 6 minutes until now. Johnson Odom with the basket.
I love that guy. I think he is going to be really good. He's athletic. He can get off the dribble.
Average 13 points per game entering this one. Kennedy with the basket on the other end for St. John's. He's got 4 points.
So this guy's been quiet, DJ Kennedy, but he has quietly become, I think, Doris, one of the best, most versatile players in the Big East from the Hill section of Pittsburgh, right really in the shadows of the University of Pittsburgh campus.
Marquette has missed its last three from three. Don't need a three there.
Look,
Acker with a beautiful pass to Fultz.
Eyes in back of his head.
Marquette back up 12, trying to advance to play Villanova. One of the teams that got the double byes at the Big East Championship. Turnover by St. John's.
Think about the heartbreaker they lost here to Villanova in the Big East Tournament.
Who was it, Reggie Redding, I think?
Yes.
That was last year after they throttled St. John's in the second round. They were up 38-10 in the first half of that game. And similar here in that St. John's struggling to score. Just 13 points and down 12. Hayward got the post up there on the 5-11. Stiff and an easy basket. Hayward's got 12 points. The lead is 14.
You know what you love about this guy? We talked about the mismatch forward. Guys his size have always figured out ways to score inside. Usually it's over length. Sometimes he can overpower you. But did you see that touch shot? That was a shot put.
He's the second all-time leading scorer at Marquette behind Jarrell McNeil. Another St. John's miss.
The way he released that pass, I thought he was going to throw the lob to the weak side of the floor or to the weak side of the basket.
Offensive rebound for Hayward, tried to go behind his back, and then finds Fultz underneath. Evans finally tracks it down. Boy, as good as St. John's looked offensively yesterday. A complete turnaround today. Can't make a shot.
And credit Marquette for that as well, Dave. We're very well prepared. They had the day off, extra day of rest.
And a Marquette foul.
Well, for Marquette, they have a culture of execution. The screens are set properly. Guys roll hard to the rim. Unselfish. This is a solid basketball team. One of the best pick and roll teams in the country. We talk about playing hard as a skill. That man knows what it's about.
I want money.
teams who've already punched their ticket to the big dance. Cornell, by virtue of winning the regular season Ivy League. Northern Iowa winning the Missouri Valley for the second straight year. Old Dominion, the team that beat Georgetown during the regular season, is in the dance.
And I don't want anybody to think Oakland is in California.
All right, that's in Detroit area.
Detroit suburbs. Greg Campy's been there probably for almost going on 25 years, maybe longer.
Meanwhile, Joe Lenardi in his latest bracketology has Marquette in. A loss today by the Golden Eagles against the St. John's would certainly hurt. But right now, they are in control, leading by 14. Here's Burrell, double team, and then tried to throw it off a Marquette player. Instead, he stepped on the baseline.
Okay, David Kubian just did. Remember yesterday we were talking about the short, choppy steps you have to take out to contest and contain a dribbler? Well, Kubian just did that. It'll be interesting to see if he's got to close out on any shooters, because that's one of the hardest things in basketball to do. Close out on a catch on the perimeter and prevent both the jump shot and the dribble drive. Bruce Weber does an unbelievable job teaching that skill at Illinois.
Smart play by Johnson Odom, but no foul called. Try to draw contact against the defender. Well, who's going to be the guy that steps up and scores? Remember, no Dwight Hardy for St. John's with a bone bruise, and he's their second leading scorer. That's in and out. Burrell is there. Maybe he's the guy.
See, he's the most capable. He and DJ Kennedy. Justin Burrell comes off the bench, but he's essentially a starter for Norm Roberts. Can hurt you with the outside shot, strong enough inside. But again, this has been a problem for St. John's. When they've struggled this year, it's because they haven't created easy baskets.
Good defense there by Lawrence. Freshman from the Bronx taking it in on Hayward. Wild shot. Getting the balance is Paris Horn. Timeout Marquette as St. John's is within 10.
Well, right there is their best offense, the ability to get out against a defense that's not set. We saw it all afternoon long yesterday. And a couple easy baskets today, only a couple of them, but here's the second one, Doris.
Well, it's why I said, if you don't turn it over, if you're Marquette and you prevent second chance opportunities, you're going to win the ball game. But this is, we've seen this twice now, where defensive plays lead to easy opportunities. And that's, to me, St. John's only shot.
The Red Storm back within 10, just over a minute to go. The winner of this game will play Villanova tomorrow at 2 Eastern. First up, it'll be Georgetown, Syracuse. Third meeting as Luke Carnesecca led to St. John's to a couple of Big East titles and a Final Four back in 1985. 25-year anniversary of that Final Four team when three Big East teams made it to the Final Four. Georgetown defeated Villanova in the title game. Or excuse me, Villanova defeated Georgetown, the lowest seed ever to win a national championship. The Wildcats were an 8 seed that year.
Don't mention that to my man Eddie Pinckney that Georgetown won that game. Now the
it was a misspeak.
70. Yeah, it was a misspeak. We'll give you credit for that.
It was a that was a frustrating. I know a lot of people liked watching. It was frustrating to me. I mean, how many shots were taken? The clock, there was no clock, no shot clock. It was frustrating to watch.
No three-point line. That three-point line came in 2 years later.
For younger college basketball fans, they marvel when they hear that. What you're telling me, there was a time where there was no shot clock and no three-point shot in college basketball?
It's when you, as a coach, used to have to practice your delay game. When you had a lead, you put the game on ice with good ball movement.
Well, the four corners from North Carolina.
That's right.
Think about that and how much time they used to, and then they get layups off you.
Fultz missing. St. John's can hold for the final shot. Rolly Massimino's Wildcat team certainly mastered that. Just a great game plan executed against a much more talented Georgetown team in that 85 title game led by Patrick Ewing. And a foul on Marquette. They did have a foul to give, though. That's two on Fultz. 16 foul. DJ Kennedy will come back into the game for St. John's, their leading scorer on the year, but Kennedy really struggled so far in this tournament. Just 4 points today, had 8 points yesterday. Burrell missing the three. Don't know if that's what Norm Roberts wanted.
It's not going to be what he wants if Marquette scores here and gets the last possession of the half.
4 seconds left here. Zacher goes away from the screen with two. With one, Hayward. Did he get it away? No. Would not have counted. Boy, Marquette had some droughts there in the first half, but still behind 12 from Lazar. Hayward leads St. John's by 10. Buzz Williams is with our Beth Mullins.
Well, Buzz, what was it about Hayward in the first half that he was so effective in making use of some mismatches out there?
Yeah, well, they're switching a lot of our ball screens. I thought we did a really good job early in the half. I thought we kind of faded defensively in the second half. Last 3 or 4 minutes, we didn't do a great job. Playing without Jimmy Butler for 18 minutes, our team's never had to do that, so I thought we did okay.
How are your traps able to stymie them offensively?
Well, we struggle enough guarding guys off the bounce. So anytime we can get two guys to guard one, it helps us.
Thank you, Buzz.
Thank you.
Coach might need a new shirt for the second half. Pretty stressful coaching here in the Garden with a lot on the line. Marquette trying to seal the deal perhaps on an NCAA tournament bid. He might be changing his shirt. Lazar Hayward with a great first half as Marquette has a 10-point lead on St. John's. Time now for the Cisco Halftime Report. John Saunders, Doug Gottlieb, Jay Williams.
Pressure dome, big city of light, so nice they said it twice. Power, wind, sweat, and sacrifice. See everything move at a fast pace, at a fast break of being last place. It's just a state of mind. In the need for success, you can find New York City.
Welcome back to Championship Week presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. It's the 2010 Big East Championship presented by New York Life. Marquette leading St. John's by 10. Winner of this game advances to play Villanova tomorrow in the Big East quarterfinals at 2 Eastern on ESPN after Georgetown and Syracuse meet for the third time this year. Dave Pasch back with Fran Fraschilla, Doris Burke. Beth Mullins will be along shortly. Well, guys, St. John's, not enough offense. Good stretches of defense, but only 17 points.
Now they can be challenged on that end of the floor. You never question their effort or their heart on the defensive end. I think they've got to handle the pressure better of those traps. Maybe one more pass, get some ball reversal. They scored half of their 17 points off the turnovers they were able to generate.
Marquette hit its first five threes, then missed its next five threes.
Well, they did, and I thought what was interesting is they played without a guy, Jimmy Butler, who was in foul trouble, only played 2 minutes. Five games, last five games, he's played 41 minutes or more, so they did it without one of their key cogs.
First half stats brought to you by New York Life. St. John's 0 for 7 from three-point land. We mentioned, though, the Red Storm had a couple of good defensive sequences holding Marquette to scoreless droughts of 444 and 342. Now, last year against Marquette in the second round, St. John's had just 10 points and only 17 in the first half of the 2010 game with Marquette here in the second round.
Remember how important it is for Marquette to score at a timeout situation. Let's see what they have.
And an easy basket for Kubion, able to get to the rim.
That's part of the special teams the Texan Buzz Williams keeps track of. ATOs, out of timeouts, inbounds plays, all part of the special teams.
Evans inside, had a double-double yesterday against Connecticut, been quiet here today. There's Hayward, led all scores in the first half with 12, but short to start the second half. Warren spotting up. St. John's now 0 for 8 from behind the arc. For the team in the road jersey today at Madison Square Garden, not shooting well. It took South Florida till the end of the game, a guy barely plays, to hit a three, and the Red Storm still looking for its first triple.
Beth Mullins had a chance to catch up with Norm Roberts. He talked about what needs to happen offensively, ball reversal, step through moves, maybe one more pass versus the traps, and defensively likes their effort. Both want to switch necessarily on those ball screens to give up threes. So communication against those ball screens, again, our thanks to Beth Mullins. Working hard over there on the sideline, friend.
And she's talking to Norm Roberts. It's always hard to talk to the guy who's down 10 and get a lot of information out of him.
You speak from experience
yes,
there.
Sir.
As Evans gets inside.
But nice. And this is something I don't think is used enough in basketball anymore, is that jump stop. That's two power moves by Evans. So obviously they're looking to generate some things through him to start the half.
Bruce Butler, the guy you talked about, Fran, played just a couple minutes, got those two quick fouls. He hit the game-winning shots against UConn and against St. John's. And without those, Marquette may be a bubble team right now, but Joe Mannardi has them clearly in as Hayward buries a three. Boy, is he tough.
Boy, is he not only tough, but if Jimmy Butler gets it going, that really stretches your defense because both of those guys are essentially for small forwards.
I love Butler. I love his speed, his ability to make long-range shots. He is fun to watch when he gets it going.
Booth in the lane. Butler with a block. Evans there to clean it up. He's playing well to start the second half. 6 points already since intermission after just two in the first frame.
Did you notice Jimmy Butler couldn't challenge Evans because he didn't want to pick up that third foul?
There's no way he's committing that foul and checking over there with Buzz.
And Butler pushed from behind by Paris Horn, his second foul.
Yeah, Corey Fisher does an unbelievable job as a guard using the jump stop. What it gives you, even as a post player, jump stop, you go off of 2 feet. So the power you generate going up off of 2 feet, good job not to foul. But again, that's an and one situation or two free throws coming because you're not going to give up the basketball going off two.
Well, 2 feet, you got better balance too. And you saw that there from Sean Evans.
The defensive play by Evans. You know, it's interesting. Both Evans and Paris Horn had better seasons last year in terms of scoring. Their numbers down this year. But St. John's winning more games. They've got 17 wins this year, the most in the Norm Roberts era. Went to the CBI last year. The chance of going to the NIT, unless, of course, they win five straight. You've got a automatic bid to the NCAAs, and nobody's done that. Shot clock at 8. Here's Kennedy off the bounce. Knocks down a 3. That's a good sign. Kennedy has struggled prior to that shot. And a timeout, Marquette. Luke Carnesecca applauds as his former school is within 6 early in the second half. DJ Kennedy, St. John's leading scorer in the season, has struggled offensively in the Big East Championship. Maybe that'll get him and the Red Storm going. St. John's, since late in the first half, has outscored Marquette 13-5 to get within 6 early in the second half. Second round action of the Big East Championship. In the regular season, when these two teams played at Carnesecca Arena, it came down to the last shot. Jimmy Butler with his second game winner. He also beat the Huskies of UConn on the road. Marquette has played a lot of close games. 5 of their 7 league losses have been by 3 points or less, and 4 of their last 5 games have gone to overtime. They've won 3 of those and lost 1. Their one loss was in the regular season finale at home against Notre Dame.
Well, Doris made a great point early in the broadcast. These guys could have really just gone to sleep after some of those losses. That's an out-of-bounds play.
Bikes backdoor, basket,
yes,
and a foul.
Special teams. You know, you always got to stay alert when you're sitting over here and it's a Buzz Williams game because they run some great stuff out of plays. Now, you know St. John's going to tighten up the defense, try to get a steal, and they use their pressure against St. John's by running that backdoor play.
That looked like a Georgetown dribble at you, go backdoor.
Took advantage of St. John's wanting to get that one more steal.
And Booth picking up his third foul. He was in our star watch. Has not had a great night. Mason missing.
That was a prime example to me of the one more pass that Norm Roberts told to Beth Mullins at the half. Okay, if he had looked to the weak side of the floor, and I know Malik Booth has struggled today, but Malik Booth was by himself on the weak side. One more pass against that track.
Here's Hayward for 3. Easy rebound for Booth at 5 feet, 8 inches tall. Kennedy with the lob, and Mason puts it in.
the easiest way for St. John's to manufacture some offense. Get a stop, put it out in transition, and allow your athleticism to make some plays.
Driving on Mason. There was contact, but no foul called as Sean Evans hit the deck.
He is an outstanding straight line driver. Yeah, he went to the rim on a backdoor cut, and he just wants to get to the 10. And whatever the fastest route to the 10 is, Bikes is going to take it.
I think he's got metal in his shorts because there's a magnet on the rim, and he knows how to go right at the rim. You're right.
Dwight Bikes, 6'3", 190 pounds, likes to get to the rim. The lob pass by St. John's, manufacturing points off their defense. Dwight Bikes off the dribble drive into the chest of Evans. I like the no call. Get up and go the other way.
Back at the Garden, the winner plays Villanova tomorrow at 2 Eastern on ESPN. Marquette by 8 as Fran takes us inside the play.
Well, Marquette prides themselves of scoring on out-of-timeout plays. This is perfect misdirection. Watch when Jimmy Butler catches the ball. Three yellow jerseys are going to go one way. He's going to turn and face. He's cleared the help side out. Back cut. Dwight Bikes finishes and one. That's well done. That's part of those special teams that Buzz Williams charts. Want to win the special teams game, just like football. Comes from Texas, and he has that kind of mentality.
And Dwight Bikes, who did not play in two of the last three regular season games, in the one game he did play, just 2 minutes, has had a very good game here today as Marquette leads by 8. But Horn cuts at the 5 on the three-point shot. St. John's didn't have a 3 in the first half. They've got 2 here in the second half.
That was an out-of-timeouts play as well. That's a designed play. Perfectly run. Suck the defense to the baseline.
A 2 of 3 from behind the arc since intermission. Here's Acker. Rebound by Mason. Kennedy on the drive. Strip and a foul called. That's on Acker, his first, and the first on Marquette.
Well, Evans has been heavily involved. They featured him as a scorer early. This time he's laying the screen so that it allows for the jump shot to come from Paris Horn. So good activity by Evans in this half.
That's what I call America's three-point play. A lot of teams run that. Drive that ball to the baseline, throw it back behind.
Paris Horn last year at the Garden at 24 points against Connecticut. Inside Mason, count it, and the foul.
Just a terrific catch. I mean, there were yellow jerseys on either side of Mason. You gotta disregard the arms and the bodies and make sure you just keep your eye on the basketball. Be tough with it. That is a playground type score right there, because no fouls called there and none called here. Finish it.
2 fouls on Hayward, 2 on Marquette. Mason cannot complete the three-point play, though. 74% free throw shooter. But St. John's within 3. They were down by 14 late in the first half. Johnson Odom taking it to the basket. Got a couple defenders up in the air. Here's Hayward. Behind the back pass. But Marquette could not complete the play, and it's St. John's ball.
Does Johnson Odom's lift the shot fakes remind you of Sam Young's?
Yeah, a little bit.
He gets bodies flying as effectively as Sam Young did.
Yeah, right now, Marquette defensively has got to match St. John's offensive intensity. Last 3 or 4 possessions, St. John's has been outstanding at executing.
We talked about how hard the Red Storm play for Norm Roberts. We saw that yesterday as they trounced Connecticut. They were down big in the first half here, but they've got it down to 3 points. As Evans inside, had a great second half. Red Storm down just 1.
DJ Kennedy did a great job of stretching that trap out, and it created a lot of space in the lane for a drive.
Evans has 8 here in the half, and the Johnnies fans here at the Garden starting to get into it now. As a quiet arena in the first half for the most part. Shot clock at 8. Johnson Odom. St. John's can take the lead. They have not led yet. Kennedy on the drive. And a foul. No basket, 13 foul on Marquette. Johnson Odom's second personal.
Take a look at this. Look how DJ Kennedy will stretch those two yellow defenders. And that opens up driving lines. And a nice dish inside. Evans finishes, but you see the versatility of a guy, DJ Kennedy. It does a lot of little things well, including handle the ball.
A lot of terrific energy here from St. John's in the second half. It's something Norm Roberts said. He said, I know my guys will always play hard. But yesterday after that UConn game, he said, they're also playing with their hearts. They trail by double digits. They know that things are in the balance for their head coach. They are playing hard. Yes, they're making mistakes as they do there. But what's their energy level? What's their effort?
Guys, we also talked about Marquette and its inability to get offensive rebounds, that if they start missing, it's an opportunity for St. John's to get back in the game. They're now struggling. Remember, they hit their first 5 threes, but they've only made one since. Hayward's going out. Let's see what Marquette can do with their best player on the bench as their lead is down to 1. Who will be the scorer for the Golden Eagles? Butler's barely played. He's their second leading scorer in the year, but he got into foul trouble in the first minute of the game. Knocks down that jumper, though.
Well, good call, Dave. You know what he does so well is drive it. The defender had to back off because they know that Jimmy Butler gets himself to the foul line. He pulled up and hit the J.
Evan sets the screen. Mason with the pass and the finish by Horn. Acker. Evans comes with a double team. Acker makes the right pass and Butler foul. Good foul there by Mason. That's his second, third on St. John's. We got a good one. Game 2 on day 2 at the Garden. Great execution offensively by St. John's, making its last 5 shots from the field to get within a point of Marquette midway through the second half.
My vision is set on the money I get. You make it anywhere. New York City.
Being 2 at 7 Eastern, North Carolina and Georgia Tech. Jimmy Butler at the free throw line. Marquette leads by 2 with 11:21 to go here in the second half. Golden Eagles or Red Storm will move on to play Villanova.
A team that's kind of hit the bump in the road. And it's funny, Jay Wright, I think it was here in January, and he said this league eventually catches up to you. I guess the point is, Franny, when does it catch up to you? For his team, the bump in the road's been late. They got to find their footing.
And I thought it was interesting that he started to play some of those freshmen more at the end of the year. They went big with Yaru and almost thought they lost a little bit of offensive rhythm. But he got those guys' experience, which should pay off in the postseason.
That game tomorrow will be at 2 Eastern following Georgetown and Syracuse. Shot clock at 5. Here's Mason in the lane. Short. But didn't miss the second time, and he ties the game.
The floor is being spaced. They're much more patient. They're executing a little bit better here in the second half.
They've got 10 field goals right now, St. John's, the second half, and 16 paint touches. Very efficient around the rim.
First tie since tip-off. With Hayward on the bench, who's going to be the guy? Kubion will. Nails a big 3.
How about this guy? From right across the river, of course, he's a Venezuelan youngster, only 1 of 4 in college basketball. Congratulations, by the way, to Grievous Vasquez, the ACC Player of the Year. Another one of his countrymen.
Kubion had struggled in his previous appearance as a Big East tournament play. Just 4 of 17 from behind the arc coming in. And that 3 there gives Marquette the lead back. And lost it out of bounds. Turnover St. John's. Booth could not handle it with Acker defending.
Now this is great effort here by Anthony Mason. A good job of St. John's. Doris, you pointed out, stretching the defense. They got it inside. And then how about this guy from St. Benedict's?
Well, another one of those plays where it's a step-through move. Another point that Beth Moen's got from Norman. How about Kubion? I mean, the guy very nearly doesn't make it to play under Coach Buzz Williams. You know, Buzz, admittedly, it was a rocky stretch, but they were able to work it out, and it's been a productive final year for Mr. Kubiak.
I think Marquette just wants to make this a close game, Dave. You think of all the games in the Big East this year that they've been in, six or seven of them right down the wire in overtime.
Turnover there by Marquette, and then a Golden Eagle foul.
You know how they have the life as in dog years? I think they should have the life in coach's years, because if Buzz Williams might be one of the youngest coaches in America, after all the close games he's played, forget about it. We'll call it coach years for him this year.
So how does that work? Does 1 year equal like 20?
Got to feel like it. Fran would know better than me.
I got 20 years back.
Three fouls now on Johnson Odom, four on Marquette. Hayward is back on the floor for the Golden Eagles. Held ball. It will stay St. John's basketball on the possession arrow.
You know, amazing stat to me. Marquette's got seven Big East losses by a total of 21 points. When you think about our first game today, what did Georgetown beat South Florida by? 20 or so?
Exactly 20.
Marquette's got seven losses by a total of 21 points in league play.
Marquette 11-7 in the conference, 20-10 overall. Joe Lunardi in his latest bracketology, ESPN.com, has them in the tournament. Don't forget two more games tonight on ESPN at 7-9 Eastern. Notre Dame Louisville playing their first games at the 2010 Big East Championship. And good hustle by Brownlee into the press table. It'll stay Marquette ball, though.
I know you're a big fan of that KenPom website. He's got a Marquette at a 66% chance of advancing to the next round of this tournament. But it might be a little bit harder than expected.
And we talked about two teams that play about as hard as anybody in the Big East. St. John certainly brings the effort every night. The offensive execution may not would it be to Norm Roberts' liking every night, but you know these guys have competed well for him, and Marquette proves in the pudding.
I'd like to see St. John's maybe get one of these New York, New Jersey kids to stay home. Jay Wright is just raiding this. There's so many teams raiding this area. You wonder if one comes. Those high school kids talk about who's playing where and who do they want to play with. Yes. If you can get one to fall your way, does that open things up? Yeah.
It sure does. It starts a pipeline.
Great hustle by Horn. Shot clock violation on Marquette. Horn got on the floor and then didn't travel with it. Turnover Marquette. 3-point lead for the Golden Eagles here in second round action of the Big East Championship presented by New York Life with Fran Fraschilla, Doris Burke. I'm Dave Pash, Beth Moens here as well. The Red Storm had 13 points with about 3 minutes left in the first half. Since then, they've outplayed. And a bad shot, but it went in. And it's a three. Shots that they've had.
A little bit of focus, they've lost a little bit of mojo, and St. John's has taken control.
Well, we saw it, Doris. We said that St. John's was working harder on offense this half.
Had to do it at the half. That was one. Make an extra pass. Step through a trap. And Louis Carnes.
Red Storm over the last minute. They've and the crowd the loudest.
Things aren't going well. Marquette, on the other hand, Dave, maybe they just 18, 11 of them have been decided by 3 points or less in conference.
And going back to Doris's comment about coach years, you know that's not true with wanting to be in close games.
And remember now, St. John's has had a number of second-half meltdowns as well, so this is a maturity process.
St. John's has had the lead in the second half of 7 of their 12 losses. As that three gets Marquette within one, second three-point field goal for Acker today. And Horn very close to a backboard violation, but it was legal. Been very patient here in the second half, getting the shots they want. Brownlee's three spins out there. Marquette looking to go back on top, and a foul called on Brownlee. Fourth on St. John's, his first. 1 point Red Storm lead. Marquette trying to figure out how to slow down St. John's, which has really picked it up. Some infighting between Kubion and Hayward. Meanwhile, totally opposite reaction for St. John's, as the Red Storm lead by one here in New York City. Back in New York City, where St. John's plays a lot of its home games here at Madison Square Garden, outscoring Marquette by 11 here in the second half, has a one-point lead. It's been a rewarding season brought to you by Discover Card. For Marquette, the Golden Eagles with 20 wins, 11-7 in Big East play. They beat Xavier, Georgetown, Louisville. Lost to DePaul. That was the only win for the Blue Demons this year. What would a loss today, how would it impact Marquette and its NCAA tournament hopes?
I think unless a lot of crazy things happen, teams on the bubble getting far in their tournaments, they're in. Let's see what they do. They're so good on inbounds plays. Let's just see what they run, Dave.
Doris, do you agree? Is Marquette in even if they lose?
I have them in. I think 11 conference wins and one this good gets them in.
Butler with the miss. St. John's with the ball. Under six to go, leading by one.
Now for St. John's, Doris, this is sort of an after timeout play because Norm Roberts drew one up in the huddle.
Booth slips but keeps his dribble. Oh, they got Evans wide open underneath. Good pass by Brownlee.
Again, the floor is spaced. You're getting a lot of shots inside where there's only one defender. St. John's is getting a lot of one-on-one opportunities right at the rim.
Hayward nails a three, ties the game at 48. That is the 4-3 of the game for Lazar Hayward, 18 points in all.
The Golden Eagles are immune to cracking in close games. They may not win this game, but they are so used to being in one or two possession games all year, they're not going to rattle.
Started 5 for 5, then missed their next 5. They're starting to get hot again after that stretch. They missed 5 in a row as Booth hits a jumper. His first basket of the game.
He had been 0 for 4. Took a bump. I actually thought he was just trying to get a foul call there. That's his strength, though, friend. You're going to bump off him more likely if you're his size.
Looks like a fire hydrant.
It's not a conditioning. They actually back him off his conditioning. He works so hard at it.
Johnson Odom, pretty move to the basket. We know he can shoot it. You guys talked about how he attacks the rim. He ties it at 50.
Well, keep reminding you guys, Marquette has been in so many of these situations all year. And for St. John's, on the other hand, how do they handle a situation where they don't melt down like they've done on a number of occasions?
Evans got the handle, can't put it in. Hayward with a rebound. Here's Acker attacking on the other end, and the Golden Eagles are back up a deuce at the 4-minute mark.
You like their mentality right now. You get the feeling, Buzz Williams said, let's get everything moving toward the rim. You see in NBA playoff games late, everybody goes off the dribble. They go right to the 10. They're either going to score a layup, Fran, or they're going to get on the free throw line, and that's what Marquette's doing.
I think he said it that, Doris, but I don't think he said it as calmly as you just said it.
Yes. And as cleanly as I just said it, perhaps.
Kennedy fancy dribbling and could not finish. The tip goes, though, by Brownlee. The big guys, Evans and Brownlee, have been brilliant here in the second half. We're tied again at 52, 3:20 on the clock. And St. John's now 12-2 over Marquette in second chance points. Oh, Johnson Odom had Butler.
Got a mismatch.
Kubion tried to lob. Hayward poked it to the corner. You see Booth get up there and almost intercept that pass. Hayward, oh, great pass with the left hand. And Butler didn't go up. He tried to pass it back out.
Boy, that was a surprise because Jimmy Butler loves contact. He's second in the league in free throw attempts, and he babied that ball up there.
And timeout, St. John's. Two remaining for the Red Storm, two left for Marquette. Both teams have committed four team fouls. Tie game with 2:39 left. You guys talked about all the close games Marquette's been in this year. Five of their seven losses decided by 3 points or less. Four of their last five games have gone to overtime. They've won three of those. They hung on to win at Cincinnati on February 21st. Jimmy Butler with a game winner at Carneseca Arena. On the 24th at Seton Hall. I don't know how that one didn't go down by Hazel. Marquette survives that one. They did finally lose in overtime the last regular season game to Notre Dame. And Marquette trying to advance to play Villanova tomorrow in the quarterfinals.
Now Doris and I got a chance to see Marquette Villanova early in the year. And you see the overtime games recently, but more important to me was when they lost to Villanova twice, Doris, by two, at West Virginia by one, and Buzz Williams never lost his team.
Well, it took some heroic shots for them to be beat. We were there for the Scotty Reynolds in the lane floater, and how many times have we seen Scotty do that? But we're talking about a young coach, somebody who had to win over this team, and when you lose that many close games early, I remember John Beilein saying to me, you have to have some things fall your way when you take over a program, because the guys have got to believe in what you're doing.
No, you're exactly right. There's nothing that engenders the confidence of your team than a coach that's well prepared for close end of game situations, and I think Buzz Williams has more than proven himself.
Meanwhile, on the other side, Norm Roberts getting this Red Storm team to play really hard. Their big win yesterday against Connecticut, and then coming back from down 14 in the first half in a position to perhaps win this game, move on to the quarterfinals. That might quiet some of the talk about whether Roberts returns for a seventh year at St. John's.
Norm Roberts said they're playing with their hearts. They need to play with their heads right now.
Last touch there by Acker. It'll stay St. John's ball.
Well, Maurice Acker is a senior, one of those experienced guys. Big moments. Get to the rim. Get it high enough so they can't get a piece. St. John's, you're not lacking for energy or effort. And you got to go hit the glass, and they do that. Offensive rebounds. DJ Kennedy, nice and soft off the rim. The follow is there. We've got a good one.
Well, emotions can change in a New York minute here at Madison Square Garden, and we've seen it. Marquette was rolling in the first half. The St. John's shot under 30%, but the Red Storm have come alive in the second half, shooting 70% from the field since intermission. We saw some of the Marquette players jawing with each other, but this is a veteran group. They bounced back. St. John's went up, but the Golden Eagles have tied it at 52 with 2.5 left. Shot clock at 8. Here's Kennedy on the drive. Can't score. Another offensive rebound. And Evans is fouled. Evans and Brownlee have been terrific in the second half on the glass for St. John.
We saw that effort yesterday against Connecticut. And one of the things I pointed out yesterday, Davis, how athletic St. John's is. We know at times they've struggled to score, but in terms of their size and strength and quickness, they've given Marquette everything they can handle.
Two quick fouls on Marquette. Now 16 fouls as Horn will go to the line.
That's a head play by Malik Booth. I mean, he saw the mismatch from inbounding the basketball, and he went right for it.
Kubion picking up the foul, only his first. And Horn is a 54% free throw shooter. Career 68% foul shooter, but had a bad year at the line. Right on cue. It's only the third free throw attempt by St. John's, only the ninth between these two teams here today. One out of two for Paris Horn. St. John's leads by a point.
Do they go ball screen with Lazar Hayward here?
Well, you know what I like about it for St. John's? They can be aggressive with only 14 fouls.
They're trying to go post up for him.
Brownlee grabbing a hold of Hayward.
Create some space. That's it. Get out of his way.
One on one. Hayward over Brownlee. Brownlee with good defense. St. John's ball and a 1-point lead. Under two to play. Booth to Horn, and he'll pull it out wisely. Plays Villanova tomorrow at 2 Eastern on ESPN. Georgetown and Syracuse first. Lazar Hayward just picked up his third foul. Seventh team foul on Marquette. So a 1-1 coming up here for the Red Storm.
St. John's has given Marquette a taste of its own medicine. They've been really good, Doris, off those screen and rolls and attacking, trying to get to the rim. That time Hayward jumped in there and wasn't able to get there in time. How about DJ Kennedy from the Hill section of Pittsburgh, play with DeJuan Blair on an AAU team, Terrell Pryor, Dave, the quarterback at Ohio State.
Yeah.
Should be 132.
The official timeout, by the way, Fran and Doris, they're just checking the clock. And apparently all is okay, so DJ Kennedy will shoot 1-1. Can you ice a free throw shooter like that in this situation with this much time left? We'll see. Kennedy, a 76% free throw shooter. Marquette ball, down one, 90 seconds left. Here's Johnson Odom with it. He drives on Evans, contact. Foul is called. That's the fourth on Malik Booth. 15 foul on St. John's.
Boy, they set up the misdirection. They cleared everybody out. They gave DJ O the room to drive.
And they called it a shooting foul there. But boy, it certainly looked like that was a pass. Luke Carnesecca wondering why that was called a two-shot foul.
I hope they're going to change it.
Good thing they did. That would be a huge mistake.
Huge.
Well, it's good when you get it right, and they did.
Yes.
Yeah.
It would have been correctable to a certain point.
Here's Kubiak. He got open because of the Hayward screen, and he buries a three to give Marquette a 2-point lead.
They have an execution culture at Marquette. Boy, do they run their stuff well.
Well, he leaned hard on that screen.
Inside of a minute remaining. St. John's down two. Timeout Norm Roberts. Buzz Williams thought that Booth committed a palming violation prior to the timeout, but did not get the call. One timeout left for St. John's.
So Lazar Hayward is the one who sets the screen. They had a little misdirection. Looked like they were going to run the post up the play prior. This time they run a little down screen for him.
Look at that screen door. Is that perfect?
Look at that, but is he moving into that screen? Is he moving with that? That's the end of the screen.
Oh,
he's holding the jersey.
Yeah,
okay.
Booth grabbed the jersey so he could push a little. but a good wide base. And Kubiak got exactly what Buzz Williams wanted.
All right, guys, if you're Norm Roberts, you've coached in this exact situation, Fran, at St. John's. Doris, jump in here as well. What do you guys think? What is the call here if you're Norm Roberts down two?
Your best playmaker is DJ Kennedy. Ability to get the ball to the rim. He's strong enough to finish. Can also drop it down. They don't have a lot of outside shooting, but I'd put the ball in his hands.
Well, the last time they did, what they did was they got him moving to the left-hand side, to his strong side, so they put him on the right side of the floor and moved him going left at the rim, and he got the free throws.
Winner plays Villanova tomorrow in the quarterfinals. St. John's with the ball down two, just one timeout left. Shot clock at 10. Here's Kennedy. Hayward will cover it. Seven to shoot. And good defense by Hayward, one of the league leader in steals. On the alternate possession arrow, it goes to Marquette.
Scout defense. He sat on his left hand. Lazar Hayward was in exactly where he needed to be, was taking him away from where he wanted to go, trying to force him right. Great defense by Lazar Hayward.
Perfect. Watch this, Doris. Now he's trying to get to his left hand. Look where Lazar Hayward is freezing for me, guys. See, look how he cuts him off, makes him come back to the right hand. That's great defense.
St. John's with a foul to give. Evans takes it there, just a second and a half off the clock. Second personal on Evans, 16 foul. Imagine St. John's will foul very early here to put Marquette at the line.
No question. Winning plays in a row. Two winning plays by Lazar Hayward, the screen and the defense. Yeah, but on the catch, a foul.
It'll be Brownlee fouling Hayward, who's one of the best free throw shooters in the Big East. In fact, in league games, Hayward shot 86% at the line.
Okay, so you question, can Lazar Hayward make it in the NBA? You want winning plays, somebody who knows how to play the game. It doesn't matter size all the time. Look at DeJuan Blair. This guy knows how to play defense.
You know, I don't know where you play him, but with 450 guys or so, can't imagine there's not a spot for him on somebody's team.
Got the front end of the 1-1. The next one would make it a two-possession game.
Dante Cunningham is playing in the NBA, has gotten some starts in the NBA.
Hey, Wesley Matthews from this team a year ago was not drafted.
Right.
Starting for the Utah Jazz.
That's exactly right.
One more for Hayward, trying to make it a four-point game. One timeout left for St. John's. We'll see if the Red Storm will use it or save it. Mason on the drive. Over Hayward, no. Rebound Butler. St. John's has got a foul, and Brownlee does. You surprised St. John's didn't use that timeout there, guys, or
no.
Were they wise to hold it?
I think they were wise to hold it. I think they needed to attack, score early. You needed two, so you wanted to save it in case you needed it.
And on the other hand, Marquette, as soon as they dribble handoff, Maurice Hackett, backer at 5'8", switched on to DJ Kennedy and was in the exact right spot he needed to be.
Here is Marquette again. In a close game. We mentioned five of their seven losses by 3 points or less. 13 games in all this year decided by 4 points or fewer. They did not lose a single game by double figures this year, but that's a big miss by Butler on the front end of the 1-1. Will they go for a quick two or a three? Horn forcing up a three. What was that? Mason there, but he missed. Kennedy gets to the loose ball. Now he's got to shoot a three. 5 seconds left. He gets the two with 4.1. St. John's will call a timeout. They obviously need the steal or the quick foul. Oh, wow, that was a wild shot to take. Still with a ton of time left, they could have gotten it inside for a quick two. Instead, the two comes with a 4.1 on the clock, and they're still down two. Let's look at our secure their spot presented by New York Life. Marquette probably in. If they lose, would they go to the bubble? Maybe, maybe not. Seton Hall's got a big one tonight. South Florida already lost today to Georgetown.
Notre Dame will get some credit for playing six games essentially without the leading scorer in the Big East. And they've actually proven, I think, to the basketball committee they're worthy because of the way they have played without their best player.
I think that's one of the more fascinating dynamics coming into this is how do they reincorporate Luke Herangode without losing all the production they've gotten from Scott and all the other guys around him. But he has been terrific. And to your point, Dave, I think you could have taken an open three if you were St. John's in that instance, not the contested three they got. So I agree with your point. Could have attacked the rim quicker.
One of the most underrated things in winning close games, guys, is getting the ball in cleanly right here. Can't tell you how many games I've seen lost because of poor presso. Let's see what they've got.
Marquette does have a couple timeouts yet if they had trouble getting in, but they did not. Acker is fouled immediately. Acker is a 78% free throw shooter. He will have a 1-1 as that's the 18th foul on St. John's. If he makes both, it'll make it a 4-point game. St. John's out of timeouts.
Now, you've heard me say this before, Dave, but if he misses one of those shots if they can't throw it the length of the court, or if it comes off a miss. St. John's will have at least three dribbles before they have to launch a desperation shot.
Or St. John's.
St. John's, yep. But it'll be incumbent upon Maurice Acker to miss one of those free throws.
Not to lose his head. He misses the free throw. You could be sulking. Instead, he pressures the basketball.
He got a little too close for my comfort as a coach. But I definitely like the intention there because he made Malik. Take a look now. Remember, as it comes off, you got about three dribbles. One, two, three. And just a little too close for me. But that's why Buzz Williams has no hair.
You can smile over here smiling because his job's not on the line right here.
I give Marquette a lot of credit. St. John's had come back and taken the lead. You saw Hayward and Kubion, a couple Marquette players, jawing at each other. But the Golden Eagles bounce back. They brush it off, and they win the game. And Buzz Williams standing by with Beth Moen.
Well, Buzz, Lazar Hayward made a couple of plays, one on the offensive end, one on the defensive end in that last minute. What makes him so good in those types of situations?
He's got the biggest heart of any player I've been around. I think he's a really good player, but I think what makes him a great player is how hard he competes and how he gets after it every single possession. And that's what gives us a chance. That's what our team relies on. We know we want him to shoot a big shot. We expect him to get a big rebound. And as bad as we played in the second half and as good as St. John's was, and as hard as they played, that was the only chance we had.
All the close games that you guys have played in this year, how do those experiences help in a situation like this?
Well, it's just what we expect. I don't mean that in a condescending way. We don't know anything different, you know? It gets close, everybody's going crazy. That's all we know. We played more close games than anything I've ever seen. So it's a one-possession game, it's a two-possession game. That's the way they've been the last 8 weeks. So that's just what we know. But I do think that the experience of it definitely helps us.
All right. Thank you very much, Buzz.
Good to see you. Thank you.
Friend, you talked about Buzz Williams lacking in hair, now lacking in voice. A lot of screaming going on during that game. But Marquette advances to play Villanova tomorrow at 2 Eastern. First up in our quarterfinal action, day three of the Big East Championship presented by New York Life. It'll be Syracuse, Georgetown. Don't forget, we got two more games tonight on ESPN. Notre Dame, Seton Hall, followed by Louisville, Cincinnati. Coming up next on ESPN, Jim Rome is burning. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Doris Burke, Fran Fraschilla, Beth Moens, our entire crew, I'm Dave Pasch. So long from the Garden. Marquette beats St. John's 57-55.